Hi everyone, welcome to my lecture. My name is Dr. Ramakrishna Hegde. Let us discuss today the specific area of data mining is called classification. Especially in the classification, we need to discuss the one of the method called rule-based classifiers here. Before proceeding, some of the materials I've used directly from a book called TAN. The data mining book. I have just referenced in the slides also. I mentioned it here. Okay. So we'll discuss about one by one what is this rule-based classifier here. Now, normally what happens, see classification task, yeah, when you think of classification task, the whole database you are dividing into two. One is a training set, another one is a test set, right? From the training set, what we will do, we apply the learning algorithms. And we come up with a model there. We'll call it the learn model, right? So this learn model normally contains a set of rules, right? This is something called a rules here. It contains a set of rules there. And this learn model, what you're going to do, we'll come up with a model. This model we are going to apply to a test set. Now we are actually testing the test set. We finding the accuracy of it, all those things, whatever your other parameters we need to find out. Then based on that, what we are going to do, we need to apply to a new data set. Right, it can be a new data set, can be a real-time data set, so whatever it is, we're going to apply to a test set there, right? So this is what the some information I would like to give, like how the classification task normally happens here, right? So now what happens in the rule-based classifier? Classify records by using a collection of if and then rules here. Learned model, what you've seen in the previous slide. Learned model is represented as set of if then rules here in the rule based classifier. Okay, learned model is represented as set of if then rules, and rules, you know that rules are a good way to represent information or bits of knowledge, right? Rules are best way to represent the bit of knowledge or maybe information also. Here the rule based classifier, what happens, as I mentioned in the previous in this particular slide, classify the records by using collection of if-then rules here. So this normally the form of an if-then rules, how it is if rule, then you have a keyword called then you have a conclusion, right? You have a conclusion. So condition is many conditions are conjunctive here, right? That means, see, in the left hand side you can see of course is we can see the rule here where condition is conjunction of attributes, right? There are many attributes. Actually, in this particular rule, you are using conjunction of attributes. And why is the label class, right? Why is the label class? Here is the right-hand side, what you are going to get it is something we'll call it as a conclusion, right? So left-hand side rule is also call it as maybe a rule antecedent or maybe a condition, right? This condition will come, condition is a conjunction of attributes. So right-hand side is a rule consequent. Rule consequent, maybe other way we'll call it as a conclusion, what you're going to get it, right? Rule consequent. Now, example of classification rules, maybe I can give it. Like you mentioned here, the blood type is equal to warm. And you can see this, blood type is equal to warm. And this particular, this is an AND, lay X is equal to yes. If both the condition are satisfied, and whatever the conclusion you're going to get is that the animal belongs to bird's family, right? It belongs to a bird's family. That means the both the condition should satisfy here. In another example, you can see if the taxable income is less than 50K and refund is equal to yes, what happens? Evade is equal to no. Evade in the sense, the person, escaping from filing the income tax return, we have taken it here. So evade is equal to no. The reason is simple because the total taxable income is what? Less than 50K, less than 50K here. And refund is equal to yes. So maybe in this particular case, what happens? If the less than 50K, that means there, if it may not be a taxable income at all, right? And also other one, you check it, refund is equal to yes. Then both the cases, what happens is evade is equal to no, right? So this is how, normally happens in the rule-based classifier, some of an example. Now, if you take this, this particular table, the database here, another example, where you have the name classes as name, blood type, give birth, and can fly, live in water, and class. You see, class you need to find out with the help of the rules here. If you apply this particular rule, see the model, the learned model normally is nothing but, you know, it is nothing but a, it contains the different rules, right? It contains the different rules like this. There are five rules you have mentioned here. Okay, rule one to rule five. If you take an example of rule one, what is the first one? It says give birth is equal to no, right? The birth value is equal to no and can fly is equal to yes. Okay, whatever you, the class you're going to get, it is, you know, it belongs to birds family, right? It's birds family. So give birth is equal to no. What is the give birth is equal to no, right? Can fly is equal to yes. Where is fly is equal to yes? Let us take it as maybe this particular case. Okay, birth is equal to no. Your birth is equal to no. Fly is equal to yes. So it belongs to, automatically belongs to bird family, right? It belongs to bird family. Like this, this particular rules can be applied for all the attributes which you have mentioned here, right? All the values, you can say, all the records, let me put it like this. There are a number of records in a real-time scenarios, right? What you can do, whatever the rules you come up with in a model, learned model, you can apply to all the records and find out the classes. What is actually predicted classes, right? That is what we are going to do it in the rule-based classifier, right? The learned model will contain the different rules here. Okay. Now, what are the application of rule-based classifier? Here, what happened? The rule R covers an instance of X if the attributes of the instance satisfies the condition of the rule. That means, the should have to satisfy the condition of the rule, right? There is a left-hand side, we have a rule, right? That rule should be satisfied. So that is what something we'll call as a rule-based classifier application of it. So if you see this particular example, we have mentioned one of the test set also here. What is the test set we have mentioned? There are two records you have mentioned. One is called hawk and another one is a grizzly bear, right? These two, we need to find out what is the class value. What is the class value based on the rule they have mentioned? There are five rules, R1 to R5, right? There are five rules you have mentioned it. So there are two records. These two records you have to check against those rules there. Suppose the first record, if you want to check it, hawk, right? You need to check it. What is the blood type you have mentioned? Is a war, right? You check against the rule. What is the rule you can apply? Suppose maybe what is the give birth? What is the value of give birth? Is equal to no, right? That is there in the first rule number one, right? Then can fly is equal to yes. Can fly is equal to yes, right? See here what happened. There are two attributes are here, right? Give birth and can fly. And these two are conjunctive right here now, right? When these two are satisfied, what happens? It belongs to bird type. See, of course, it's given here, right? In this particular record, what happens? Hawk is the name. And here what happens? You can see give birth is equal to no, right? It satisfies this condition. Then another one, can fly is equal to yes. It satisfies this condition also. So both the conditions are satisfied. What is the conclusion you're going to get it here? The conclusion is supposed to be what? Bird. So the class, what you're going to get it here is values what? Bird here. Class value is supposed to be bird here, right? So if you take another example like a grizzly bear, in this particular what happens, you check with the rules against here. There are five rules, right? Check against. So give birth is equal to yes. Do you have any give birth is equal to yes here? Of course, yeah. In the rule number three says give birth is equal to yes, right? Now, can fly, of course, it is not here. Then blood type, it is there. Here is a blood type is mentioned. Blood type is equal to war, right? Give birth is equal to yes, that's value we have it, and blood type we have it is a warm. So when both the conditions are satisfied, what is the conclusion you are going to get it? It is a mammals, belongs to mammals class, right? So this is how maybe rules are applied to a test set, and also if it is the accuracy of the whatever you're going to apply is good, then you are going to apply for the new data set, right? This is what we're talking about, application of rule-based classifying in this particular example. That means whatever the record you are going to get it, that record you need to check against the rules, right? So if any one of the rule is satisfied with that, then respective conclusion, maybe other way in this particular case, we'll call it, so we are going to predict the classes. It belongs to which class? That we're going to predict here, right? Now what happens? Then how do you predict? Or maybe I can say, how do you see the quality of the particular rule is all about? What is the quality I'm talking about? How do you decide? Now, there are two very important parameters we need to know. One is the rule coverage. Another one is the accuracy. Now, the coverage of the rule is, you can define fraction of records that satisfy the antecedent of a rule, right? fraction of records that satisfies the antecedent of a rule, right? In this particular example, we have in the right hand side, you can see in this particular example, you have taken one of an example as status. Okay, status is the one which you have taken it, marital status. Status is equal to single. This one you have taken, this particular rule you have taken it here. Now, if you status single, no, okay, this one. This is what we have taken it. And the conclusion is mentioned as no, status is equal to single, conclusion is no, right? So here what happens, if you take this particular example, the coverage of the rule comes, you have to find out how many, marital status, it is mentioned as single here. How many? You can see marital status is one, it's as a single, then is the second one, and the third one, and the fourth one. How many times you have? Four here, right? And in other way, the coverage R can be defined or maybe can be calculated as N covers, okay? N covers in the sense, number of times the particular single is arrived, maybe appeared, right? Number of time, in this particular example, number of times single is appeared divided by total number of transactions. How many number of transactions here? There are now 10 number of transactions, you can see. There are 10 number of transactions here, right? So D is nothing but is a total number of transactions. This is N covers how many number of times the single is appeared in this particular case. That means how many? 1, 2, 3, 4. 4 divided by 10. What is the percentage? Is equal to 40%. So coverage is equal to how much here? For this particular example, coverage is equal to 40%. Coverage is equal to 40%. Now the second parameter is very important. Accuracy of the rule, right? How accurate? You have a model, right? Learned model. That learned model you need to test on testing set. Now, when you apply for the testing set, you'll get some classes, the prediction you'll get it. Then you need to find out the accuracy of the prediction, how accurate it is, right? That is what we'll call it as the accuracy of the rule. Accuracy of the rule, what happens? A fraction of records that satisfies antecedent that also satisfies the consequent of the rule. That also satisfies the consequent of the rule. That means conclusion, what you're going to get, it also satisfies the consequent also. Right, conclusion also. So that can be defined. Accuracy of R is equal to n correct. N correct in the sense, see whatever coverage you have mentioned here, right? Single in this particular case, you have taken as a single here, right? N correct in the sense, even it checks for the consequent rule also. In the coverage rule, what happens? We are not going to check for the consequent rule. Instead, we are going to check it as only antecedent. We are checking only antecedent here. We never going to touch in the touch the consequent in the coverage rule. But when it comes to accuracy rule, what happens? You are going to do it for both antecedent as well as consequent, both, right? This is what is something we'll call as a consequent. In the sense, you have the conclusion what you're going to get it here, right? Yes or no. And here in this case, you can see the no is a consequent here, right? Whenever the status becomes single, what is the consequence is equal to no, right? The value is no. That means evade value is supposed to be what? No. Now, accuracy R is equal to N correct divided by N covers. That means, N correct is how much here? In this case, for example, this is what you're supposed to check it, right? Status is equal to single. If it is status equal to single, answer should be no. That means, what is the consequent equal to no? You check for this. See, status is equal to single, class equal to no, right? This satisfies. It checks both, right? This is what we'll call it as antecedent, what you're going to check it. This is what we'll call it as what? Maybe a consequent, right? So there is number one is satisfied. If you go here, single, answer is also no. Yes, the second one is satisfied. Go to the third one. Here what happens? Single, this will satisfy, but this will not satisfy. Here answer is yes, right? But here is what is no. So this will not satisfy. If you go to another one, single, it is again yes. So this also will not be satisfied. Then how do you, what is the accuracy you are going to calculate here? There are two, right? These two are satisfied. So 2 divided by N correct value is equal to 2 here. Then N covers is equal to how much? There are 4. Say 1, 2, 3, 4. Right? N cover is equal to 4. So that means N correct is equal to 2 divided by N covers is equal to 4. So 2 by 4 is equal to 50%. So accuracy is how much here? Only 50% here. Accuracy is equal to here in this particular case is only 50%. Got it now? Rule coverage and accuracy is very important because you actually need to evaluate the particular rules, how you know what is the rule coverage and accuracy. This is very important here. Now let's move on to how does this rule classified normally works. There are two very important words you need to remember here. Fires, right? Whenever it satisfies the particular rule, it fires. means that whenever it fulfills the particular condition, it fires, right? That's what you are talking about, the fires. Now, how does rule-based classifier work here? If you see this, there are five rules here, right? Give birth is equal to no, and can fly is equal to yes, right? This is the rule number one. Answer is equal to what? Yes. So that means answer is equal to birds here. Second rule, give birth is equal to no, okay? We have taken an earlier example, okay? And live in water is equal to yes. When both the conditions are satisfied, then it belongs to fishes. Then rule number three is what? Give birth is equal to yes and blood type is equal to warm. And it belongs to, if both conditions are satisfied, then it belongs to mammal category classes. Like this other two rules also, we can see. There are five rules here. Then if you apply this rule to the each and every record in this particular case, what happens? First one is a lemur, right? Lemur is the first name what you have. You check with the rule here, which rule it satisfies in this particular case. Rule number three, right? Rule number three, what is that? Give birth is equal to yes, right? Then blood type is equal to warm. Blood type is equal to warm. This will be get satisfied. So classified as a mammal. Classified as a mammal, right? Then if you go to a second one, it satisfies only one condition in this case. It satisfies only one condition here in this particular case, okay? For the first record. Let us move on to a second record. What happens? What is the second record is? See, give birth is equal to no, right? And can fly is equal to no, right? Record number, what is the rule number four is also get satisfied. Then you can go for live in water is equal to sometimes. Where is that? Live in water is equal to sometimes, okay? Live in water is equal to sometimes. This also satisfies. Then, of course, live in water equal to sometimes. This also satisfies, right? That means, what you call it as ambivalence. So what happens in this particular case, rule number four and five, will get satisfied. Both rules are get satisfied in the sense, whenever it's satisfied in the sense, it triggers. Okay, it triggers. See, here, for the first case, for the first record, rule number three is satisfied, right? Whenever it's satisfied, it triggers. Okay, lemur triggers rule number R3 because it satisfies that. So it is classified as a mammal. It triggers in the sense it fires. It fires. Okay. Second case, what happens? The turtle. There are two rules. Rules will triggers. Right. That means two rules will be get satisfied. What happens? It triggers both rule R4 and R5. Turtle. The record number two. Turtle is triggers both rule number R4 and R5. It fires both because it satisfies both the rules. Then with the last one is a dogfish shark. What happens? None of the rules are satisfied here. Right? Here, none of the rules are satisfied. What happens? Shark triggers none of the rules. That means the record number three, which contains the name as a dogfish shark, will not satisfy any one of the rules which is mentioned out of five rules there. That means it will not trigger none of, it will not trigger any rules. In the sense, dogfish shark triggers none of the rules. It satisfies none of the rules here. This is how the rule-based classifier normally works. Okay. Now, what happens? We are talking about. Suppose one record which triggers two rules simultaneously. Then how do you? Which is the rule you need to assign? Assign it, or maybe which is the rule it's supposed to consider? Which is the rule it's supposed to consider? That's very, very important, right? Before deciding that, we need to find out first what are the characteristics of the rule sets. Characteristics, some of the characteristics. Strategy number one is mutually exclusive rules. Okay, in this case, what happens? Classifier contains mutually exclusive rules. If the rules are independent of each other, then it comes under mutually exclusive rules. And every record is covered by at most one rule. At most one rule. Every record should have to cover at most one rule. At most one rule, not more than that. At most one rule, okay? Then second one is exhaustive rule. Exhaustive rule, rules what happens. See, exhaustive coverage is the classifier as an exhaustive coverage. If we talk, accounts for every possible combination of an attribute values. That means every possible combination of attribute values will be considered in the exhaustive rules here. And also, every record is covered at least one rule, okay? It can have, any number of rule can be, any number of rules can be applied, but here at least one rule should have to satisfy every record. Each record is covered by at least one rule. But when mutually exclusive, what happens? At most one rule there. There it is at most one rule, but in this case, it's at least one rule. Okay. Then strategy number two, here rules are not mutually exclusive. Here what happens, a record may trigger more than one rule also. As I said, this earlier case we have discussed, right? There are the record which is named as a turtle, which actually triggers two rules, R3 and R5. There are two rules it triggers, right? You satisfy two rules, right? That is why the rules are not mutually exclusive, right? Solution is what? There are solutions, you have to order the sets there, order rule set, we'll call it as. In this sense, you have to prioritize, okay? We'll discuss what is order set, then you can be able to understand. Unordered, second one is unordered rule set. That means use the voting schemes there. Another one is the rules are not exhaustive. A record may not trigger any rules. That is what we have seen it, right? The example number three, where dogfish will not satisfy any, if you see this particular example, right? This dogfish will not satisfy any one of the rules here, will not satisfy. So it will not trigger any rule here. It will not trigger any rule here. That means that is for no exhaustive. This is what rules are not exhaustive. Rules are not exhaustive here. Okay. That means record may not trigger any rules because it will not satisfy anything. Right. Then solution is use a default clause. Whenever it will not trigger any rules, use the default clause. That's what you're supposed to do. There is a default class value, you need to use it. In the earlier, what is the default class value here? Default class value is supposed to be what? MPBNC is a default class value. Right? MPBNC is a default class value, you have assigned it. So you, whenever is no, is set, nothing is satisfied, no rules are satisfied, straight away, what you can do, you can go with, what is that? Default value. Okay? Default value here. So order rule set, here when in the strategy number one, in that we have mentioned that, maybe in the strategy two, we have mentioned that one of the solution is ordered rule set. Here what happens, I given a simple example earlier, right? That is one of an example called turtle. It triggers two rules. It triggers two rules. That means it satisfies two rules. Then how do you decide which rule can be suitable for this? Then which rule can be assigned to this? This is where you need to come up with ordered rule set here. What happens? Rules are ranked, ordered according to their priority. Okay? According to their priority. So here what happens? Two rules are satisfied. Then conflict resolution strategy to figure out which rule get to fire and assign its class prediction. Okay? So what happens, rule ordering, which prioritize the rule beforehand. Okay. Rule ordering, which prioritize rule beforehand. Okay. Then here, when a test record is presented to the classifier. Okay. When the test record is presented to the classifier, it is assigned to the class label of the highest ranked rule it has triggered. Okay. So if none of the rules are fired, it is assigned to the default class, right? So that every class will have some default value. So if none of the rules are fired, it is assigned to the default class, okay? So rule number one, R1 is give birth is equal to no, and can fly is equal to yes. What is the result you are going to get? It is as a birds, right? Then rule number two is give birth is equal to no, and live in water is equal to yes. Conclusion is equal to yes. Fishes. Okay. Like this, you have mentioned it. If you see this particular example, okay, R4 is a turtle. Okay. Then the value is supposed to be what? Reptile. Here we assigned here. This is order. We are ordering it here on their priority. On their priority, we have done it here. Okay. Then rule ordering scheme. Rule ordering scheme, what happens? This particular case, individual rules are ranked based on their quality. Individual rules are ranked based on their quality. How do you decide the quality of it? The quality can be decided based on the, there are two, three parameters like accuracy, coverage, and the size. And sometimes it's based on, expert advice from the, maybe advice from the domain experts also, right? That's what I'm talking about, the quality here. Individual rules are ranked based on their quality, right? So quality means based on the accuracy, it can be a size, or it can be a coverage, or it can be a expert advice from the expert domain experts. Okay, you can consider anything based on that quality. You have to individual rules are ordered here. Then class based ordering, what happens? This particular case, classes are sorted in order of decreasing importance. That means decreasing order of prevalence, decreasing order of prevalence, or maybe the frequency, most frequent one, right? So if it is the highest prevalence one, what you can do, you can order it first. You can write it as a first one, they appear as the first one, okay? Then next prevalence, you can come to a second one. Third prevalence comes to a third one, okay? Based on the importance of it, right? Frequent, we can call it as frequency. So this is what we'll call it as. So maybe class-based ordering. In the class-based ordering, what happens? Rules that belongs to the same class appears together, right? We can see the rule-based classified ordering. What we will do, based on the quality of the particular rule, we are going to organize it. Maybe we are going to rank it, right? Refund is equal to yes. Of course, it may be having the highest quality, depending upon any one of the, it can be accuracy or maybe a size, maybe whatever, you know, advice from the experts, whatever it is, right? Refund is equal to yes, which is having the highest quality. Maybe which the refund is equal to no. Marital status is equal to single, divorce, whatever it is, the second quality. Maybe we're having a next highest quality. This may having a next highest quality. This may having a next highest quality. So based on the highest quality, what you will do, you are just ordering it. Now the next one is a class-based ordering. In the class-based ordering, as I said, we actually, arranging decreasing order of prevalence, right? Decreasing order of prevalence and rules that belong to the same class appear together, right? This is how you mentioned it here. This is refund is equal to yes. This is order of prevalence is high. So we mention as the first one. Then refund is equal to no, marital status is equal to single or divorced. Okay, taxable income is less than 80k. Okay, evade is equal to no. This can be a next prevalence one. Next prevalence, like this. This is the next prevalence, and refund is equal to no. This one, you can see this rule based ordering. The quality may be, as per the quality, it comes the third. It comes in the third order here, you can see. But in a class based ordering, what happens? It comes in the last year. Comes in the last year. That means order of prevalence, most frequent one or not. Okay, based on that, it actually class-based ordering will be done. So order of prevalence based on the class-based ordering, it comes fourth here. But rule-based is comes in the third. Rule-based always based on the quality we are going to rank it. Class-based ordering, we are ordering maybe we arrange it based on order of prevalence. Okay, this is how rules ordering scheme will be there. Then build classification rules. See, in the build classification rules, there are two very important here. Classification rules. One is a direct method. What actually the direct method will do? You have a training set, right? Directly from the training set, you derive the rules. Directly from the training set, you derive the rules. This is what we call as a direct method. There are some of an example. We have a refer, CN2, some of many are there. Okay. Then another one is like an indirect method. Indirect method, what happens here? We are not going to directly derive from the training set. Instead, the training set, whatever you have, right? That we are going to arrange in the form of a decision tree. Right, decision tree. I can put it like this. One of an example is a decision tree, or maybe neural network, whatever it is. Here, what happens? Extract the rules from other classification methods. Right. See, we have a decision tree is one of the classification method. Right. You have a training set. Maybe you come up with a rule. Based on the rule, what you are going to do? You are deriving the decision tree. Based on the decision tree, you can write a class also. Maybe a rules also. Right. What happens? Based on the other classification tree, you are going to extract the rules. That's what we'll call it as an indirect method. One of an example is a decision tree, and maybe other one is maybe a neural network, whatever you're going to call it as. Maybe one of the methods supposed to be used, maybe example is C4.5 rules. Okay. Now we'll see what is this direct method is all about. See, the direct method, what happens? We sequentially covering, we are going to, one of the method we are going to use it called sequential covering. Sequential covering, what actually you're going to do? Here what happens? Directly from the training set, right? And sequential covering algorithm are mostly widely used algorithm in the mining now, right? Mining disjunctive sets of classification rules. Here, rules are learned from one class at a time. Remember, here rules are learned one class at a time. Here, learned from one class at a time in a sequential covering. Here, what happened, the steps are mentioned here. Start from the empty set, okay? Start from the empty set, then a grover rule, using learn one rule function, in the sense one set, one rule at a time, you come up with function. Remove the training cover recovered. remove training records covered by the rule. Okay. then repeat the step 2 and 3 until stopping criteria is met, right? So we'll see one up an example how things will work here. The example of sequential covering, okay? Sequential covering. So initially, this is what the original data, what you have. You can see the positive classes and the negative classes also, right? Positive classes and the negative classes, you have it. This positive classes, see, when you apply the sequential covering, what happens? It checks for the first empty set. You start with the first, then it goes to a first positive classes here. What is the positive class? You can see this one. There are six, five, so maybe a plus here, right? So this is this one you decide as rule number one. Positive class, rule number one. What is the next one is supposed to be? This is the next one, right? It goes to a next one. You can see this. Step number two is supposed to be, of course, rule number one is defined here. What is the next one? This one. Here, one negative class you can see, right? One negative class you can see. This negative class, you need to remove it, right? Step number two, what happens here? You can see. This is the rule number two. Of course, there is a negative class. One negative class will be there, including negative class. You're derived as a rule number two here. Okay. When pruning, what you will do? Maybe negative class can be pruned here. Then the next stage. Before that, you just classify. This is the rule number two. Then what is the next one? This should become a rule number three, right? Wherever plus classes you have it, positive classes you have it, this has become rule number three, step number three, right? This is what the rule number three comes into picture. Rule number three. This has become R3, right? Now, whenever the, whatever attributes you have it, if it is satisfied the rule number one, just remove that from the training set. Just remove from the training set like this, right? Rule number one satisfied, remove it. Then here is some of the positive classes arrived, remove it. Then you should go for the rule number three like this. This is a step number three, okay? Then instance elimination is very important here. Instance elimination, what happens here? Why do you need to eliminate instances? Otherwise, what happened? The next rule is identical to the previous rule. In the sense, see, while deriving the rules here, that there is a possibility that there are few rules maybe having an identical rule. Rules are identical. Why do you want to keep many identical rules together? Right? You can keep only one rule, and other similar rules or maybe identical rules, you need to eliminate it. Right? That is where we need a the eliminate instances. Right? We need to eliminate the instances there. When it comes to eliminate instances, there are two instances. One is a positive instances. Okay, positive instances. In the positive instances, what happened? Why do you remove the positive instances? Is to ensure that whatever the rule you are going to derive it for the next rule, that is going to be different compared to the previous rules. That is what is supposed to be. That is the purpose of removing the positive instances, right? Positive instance, you need to remove to get. Whatever the rule you're going to divide next, right, should be different from the rule which is already there in the previous rule, right? Then another one is called remove the negative instances. The purpose of the removing the negative instance is to see, sometime what happens, we underestimate some of the accuracy of the rule, right? Of course, there are many rules. There are R1, R2, R3, there are three rules here, right? Sometime you are underestimating the accuracy of the rules, right? To prevent that underestimation of the rule, what we will do, we are just removing the negative instances. Imagine in this particular case, rule R3 and R2, okay? We can see rule R3 and R2. What happens is similar, almost similar, right? Almost similar here. What you can do, you just remove the negative one. Just remove the negative instances here. You come up with you just remove it, right? So that you are, you are preventing the underestimating the accuracy of the rule here. Wherever the negative class comes, just remove it, right? So compare the rule R2 and R3 in the diagram, then you can able to make out here, right? Then rule growing, in the rule growing, there are very two common methods here. One is called a general to a specific. General to specific, actually we start from the more general one, in the sense from we'll start with an empty set, right? We'll start with an empty set. Then we'll go with the more specific one, right? General one means we actually the top-down approach, right? Start with the empty set, right? Then we go one by one, keep on adding conjunction to it, right? What happens? So we choose the empty set, right? One of the rule set, then keep on adding more and more attributes to a more and more attributes and more and attributes as a conjunctive, right? Keep on adding more and more. You come up with a better rules, maybe. You're deriving the rules maybe from empty set to more attribute, the rules which may contain more attribute, which is conjunctive, right? You are using conjunctive, right? Different conjunctive. So you come up with a better rules. That is what we'll call it as a general to specific. It is more on top to bottom approach, right? So here you can see this is an empty set. Okay, from empty set to you come up with a more specific one. Refund is equal to no is more specific. Then status is equal to single is more specific. Status equal to diverse is more specific. You come up with more specific one. Status is equal to married is more specific like this, right? And whatever the value you have mentioned it, maybe three times appeared here. Refund is equal to no is three times appeared. Okay. If yes is the one equal to appeared three times and no is appeared four times. If refund is equal to no, it may appear no is equal to four times, yes is equal to three times. Okay. Satisfy this particular condition. Status is equal to single. Okay. When status equal to, there are two times satisfies this particular condition and one time it will not satisfy the condition. And status equal to diverse, what happens? There are one time it satisfies this particular condition, other times no, maybe like this. This is what the general to specific. Then you can go for more, another one is called specific to general. You start with the more specific one first. This is bottom up approach, I can say, bottom up approach. Where you start with the more specific one, then move on to the up, in the sense, more general one. Move on to more general. Start with the more specific, then move on to general one, more general. This is what the specific to general is all about. You can see you start with the refund is equal to no, status is equal to single, class is equal to yes. This is what more specific one, where you keep on moving on to a more generalized one, more generalized one. Refund is equal to no, status is equal to single, income is equal to 85k. Okay, we are keep on moving on to more generalized. In this case, also the same. Okay, this is what two common strategies. One is a general to specific and specific to general. Then rule evaluation, we use one of the very important one, we'll call it as FOIL, first order inductive learner. Okay, and this is what is supposed to be used. And what happens, initially you come up with an empty set, right? Then you keep on adding different attributes in a conjunctive, keep on adding conjunctive here. When you keep on adding conjunctive, what you're supposed to do, whenever the new rule arises, then you need to find out the gain of it. Okay, what is the gain? The formula to calculate the gain is, for example, in this case, R0 we have mentioned as an empty set, okay, initial rule. Then you have an next rule you have derived it, then you're added more conjunctive, right? You're adding more attributes to that. Adding more and conjunctive here. Rule after adding conjunctive, right? Conjunct. Then R1 is you come up with another rule. Now you, find out the gain for these two. R0, gain of R0 and R1. When you come up with the R1, right, you're added more attributes here. Then what is the gain you got it? That you need to calculate here. Gain R0, R1 is equal to T into log of P1 divided by P1 plus N1. This case, what happens? P1 is number of positive instances covered by R1. Okay. N1 is, we'll call it as number of negative instances in the covered by R1. Okay. P1 is the number of positive instances covered in R1. N1 is the number of negative instances covered in R1 here. Okay. Log of P1 divided by P1 plus N1 minus log of P0. In the sense, number of positive instances covered in the R0. Okay. In rule R0. Number of positive instances covered in rule R0. And N0 is number of negative instances covered in rule R0. Okay. With the help of this formula, what you can do, you can calculate the gain. If you have a gain, gain is nothing but actually you are actually get benefited. That means there may be chances of accuracy is more, right? Coverage is more, or maybe something like that may be an effect on size also. In the sense, you are actually gaining in one of the parameter, right? So that gaining you need to calculate. Whenever you gain it, what you can do, that is become the next rule, right? That is more effective rule, right? You come up with that. So this is how the rule can be evaluated, right? Then a direct method, of course, there are two things you need to consider. One of an example you've taken is a refer here. So for the two class problem, what happened? Choose one of the classes as a positive class and remaining all you treat as a negative class. Okay, two class problem. One of the thing you choose as a positive class, remaining all you choose as a negative class. Now for the whatever the rule you need to derive, you have to derive the rules, right? Normally what actually you are going to do, you're learn the rule from that positive class, because one of the things you have taken as a positive class, right? For that positive class you learn the rule, and remaining whatever the negative class you have, right, that is supposed to be what? It's a default class, will be a default class. All the negative classes, the class will be a default class. First case. Second case, what happens is a multi-class problem. Multi-class problem, what happens? Order the classes according to the increasing class prevalence. Increasing class prevalence, in the sense, the frequency, most frequent one, most prevalence one, most prevalence one, most frequent one come first. Then the next prevalence one comes to the second. Next prevalent one comes third. Based on this, what you will do, you're ordering all the classes here. Ordering all the classes. Then learn the rule set from first smallest, or maybe I can put it as smallest class first. Okay, whenever is smallest class arrived, that comes first. You can see how it's supposed to be smallest class first. I'll just show you this with the one of an example, then you can able to understand, right? This is the smallest class, right? You can see refund is equal to yes, it arrived first here. Like this, the most prevalent one, most frequent one, you're supposed to find out here, right? So, here, then smallest class first, and treat the rest as a negative class here. Whenever choose one positive class, remaining everything you have to choose it as, maybe you have to treat as a negative class. Then what happens? Repeat the same step for the next smallest class. Repeat the same step for the next smallest class as a positive class. Then the steps will be repeated until there is no more smallest class are available. It should be repeated until the no more smallest classes are available, right? This is the direct method, is a ripper. And here in the ripper, what happens, the growing rule, you start with an empty set, right? Add a conjunctive as long as it improve false information gain, keep on adding the conjuncts there, right? Then stop when rule no longer covers the negative examples, okay? No longer covers the negative examples. Then prune the rule immediately using the incremental reduced error pruning here. The pruning is goes like this. V is equal to P minus N. P is the number of positive examples covered by the rule in the validation set. Okay. N is the number of negative examples covered in the rule in the validation set. Okay. With the help of this particular formula, the measure of pruning you can able to calculate. Pruning in the sense you are just discarding the particular one, or maybe you are removing it, right? Pruning. Why the pruning is necessary? Because of the, whatever the rules you may come up with may have some, unnecessary, conjuncts there. Unnecessary conjuncts there. Those unnecessary conjuncts, what you can do, you can prune it so that you make simple, more effective one. Okay, that's what is the pruning is all about. The how do you measure the pruning? With the help of this particular formula which I mentioned, V is equal to P minus 1 divided by P plus 1, N. Okay, now pruning method, of course, deleting up, this is what we are talking about. Now, with the next one in the ripper, is you need to build a rule set. Rule set, what you will do, you actually are applying the sequential covering algorithm that already we have discussed, sequential covering algorithm, right? Apply that. Then each time a rule is added to the rule set, compute the new description length. This is very important. New description length you need to calculate here, right? Then the next one in the ripper is optimize the rule set. How do you optimize it? Actually, you come up with the one rule, right? Then for that, when you add, you can see, consider two alternative rules here. One is a replacement rule. Okay, R star, grow the new rule from the scratch, right? Initially you have R, right? This is the original rule. You have to alter this, right? You have to replace the rule. That replace, how do you replace the rule? Grow a new rule from the scratch, right? You have another one alternative rule. You're talking about revised rule is an R dash. R dash, what happens? You are keep on adding the conjuncts. Keep on adding the conjuncts to the extended rule R, right? Keep on adding the conjuncts so that when you keep on adding the conjuncts, what happens? It will have more attributes, more conjuncts you have it. That is what we'll call it as an R dash, right? Now compare the rules set of R against the rules for R star as well as R dash, then try to minimize it. Try to minimize it, okay? And repeat the rule generation and rule optimization for the remaining positive examples also. This is what is normally done in the optimizer rule set, okay? Then another method is called the indirect method here. Indirect method, what actually happens, we are not directly deriving from the training set here. Instead, so the classes is already derived with one of the method, called decision tree, right? Or maybe neural networks, right? Anyone, maybe there are many methods are there, right? You are represented already, those training, maybe rules there. In this example, we'll take a decision tree. Here is the decision tree we have taken, right? We start with the P. If the p value is no, then go to q. If the q value is no, then go to minus negative class here, like this, right? this is the decision tree. With the help of a decision tree, actually you are deriving the rule here. That means this is indirect methods, right? This is actually an indirect method what you are going to do it here, right? Indirect method what you are going to do it. If you see this particular example, you know, you derived a rule, rule number one, P is equal to no, Q is equal to no. What is the conclusion you are going to get it? Is a negative class, right? The conclusion what you are going to get it is a negative class. Maybe you come up with a rule number two, P is equal to no, okay? Then Q is equal to yes. What is the conclusion you are going to have it? Here is a positive class here, right? This is the second rule you have derived it. In that sense, P value is equal to no, then Q is equal to yes. Whatever you're going to get it is a class, is going to be a positive class. Like you can derive other classes also. Like R3, you can see P is equal to yes, right? Then R is equal to yes, then Q is equal to no. P is equal to yes, R is equal to yes, Q is equal to no. Okay, traverse like this. When you traverse like this, what is the conclusion you will have it? It's a negative class. Conclusion you have it is a negative class here, right? Then if you take another one, R5, you can see P is equal to yes, R is equal to yes, Q is equal to yes. What is the value you're going to get it? Is a positive class. What you're going to get if you traverse like this, you're going to get a positive class here. P is equal to yes, R is equal to yes, Q is equal to yes. So this is a positive class. This is what normally called as an indirect method, okay? So with the help of a decision tree or maybe a neural network, you come up with a rule, right? This is what we'll call it as an indirect method. In the indirect method, we have very, most popular one is called the C4.5 rules. Here, what happens, extract the rule from the unpruned decision tree. Unpruned decision tree in the sense, you have not optimized, okay? You have not optimized or maybe you have not deleted any redundant one. You have not deleted, this unpruned one, unpruned decision tree. There may be a chances that you know, some of the classes, maybe an attribute may repeat again and again, right? Some of the classes, maybe attributes or maybe a conjuncts may repeat again and again. That's what we'll call as an unpruned decision tree. We use an untuned decision tree here to extract the rules. And for each rule, R, A belongs to Y, of course, whatever you're going to calculate, then consider alternative rule. You come up with R dash. What happens? You are keep on removing one of the conjuncts, right? A dash, you come up with the rule R dash, okay? Come up with the rule R dash, alternative rule, you come up with R dash. What you will do in the R dash, you remove one of the conjunctive, then find out the effectiveness of it. You may be hundreds of conjunctive in the particular rule. You remove one of the conjunctive, find out the effectiveness of it, find out the accuracy and the coverage of it, right? Then compare with the pessimistic error rate for a R against R dash, all the R dash, okay? Pessimistic error rate. And prune if one of the alternative rules has a lower pessimistic error rate. Prune it again if one of the alternative rules has a lower pessimistic error rate, right? Repeat it until we can no longer improve the generalization of error. In the sense, here it goes like this. You come up with an alternative rule, okay? Many alternative rules. You compare with the original rule. Right? How do you come up with a different, R dash? You're just removing one of the conjunctive, you come up with R dash. Next time what happens, remove one more conjunctive, come up with the second R dash. Remove one more, come up with the third R dash. Like this, you can come up with the many R dash there. Compare with the original one. Then whenever the pessimistic error rate is low, then prune it again. Prune it again, right? Whenever the pessimistic error rate is low, prune it again. Then you need to repeat the complete step as long as no longer improve generalization error, you can able to get it. Okay, so this is what we'll call it as C4.5 rules, okay, indirect methods. And of course, maybe you have, instead of ordering the rules, you can come up with or order a subset of rules also. We'll call it as a class order, okay? And this is another, we'll take this particular example, then we can able to compare with. So C4.5 versus C4.5 rules versus refer. This particular case, what happens? C4.5 rules, you traverse it, what is that? Give birth is equal to no. Can fly is equal to yes. What is a family belongs to? Birds family, right? This is actually subset of this. Give birth is equal to no. Live in water is equal to no. And can fly is equal to yes, right? This is actually one set. For that, whatever you mentioned is a subset of this actually, right? It comes under, maybe it satisfies one of the condition here, right? give birth is equal to no here. Yes, satisfies. Then can fly is equal to yes. Yes, can fly is equal to yes, right? This condition is satisfied. This condition is satisfied. That means it belongs to God's family. Like give birth is equal to no. No. Then live in water is equal to yes, right? It satisfies. Travels like this. A conclusion is fishes here, right? In the same way, it applies the other things also, right? Then ripper, what happens? Live in water is equal to yes. Live in water is equal to yes. Again, is a fishes here. Then have legs, no. Okay, have legs is no. There's a reptile. That is what the have legs. Can fly or not, right? Can fly or not in the sense, no means that is having a legs, right? Have legs, no. Then it is a reptile. Legs, no, right? Then give birth is equal to no. Can fly is equal to no. Live in water is equal to no. It is going to be a reptile. So it's traverse along the whatever you have it. So what happens? Why I'm showing this? I'll show you the next table. The value which you have calculated, which have entered in the table, based on the C4.5 rules and C4.5 versus ripper. What happens? Whatever the value, the class, the predicted class you are going to get it is totally different, right? If you see this particular example, this particular table actually shows C4.5 and C4.5 rules here. Whatever the value you're going to get it here, right? Maybe I can say predicted classes you're going to get it here is different than whatever entered in this predicted class here, in this particular case, ripper class, right? If you see this example, like amphibians, here what happens, amphibians is 2, you have it, right? And mammals is 0, fishes 0, reptiles 0, everything is 0 except amphibians. But this case, what happens when you use the ripper here? Amphibians is 0, but mammals is 2. That means the value is different here. In this particular case, mammals is 0, but in this case, mammals is become 2 here. That means when you compare this, the values become totally different. In the sense, the values may be different, right? That is the reason why you need to be very careful while using these rules, C4.5 rules as well as reverse. Very important here, because whatever the predicted value, it may change. Predicted class value may change. Okay, it should be very important. You need to note down this. Then some of an advantage of rule-based classifier. Of course, you know that rule-based classifier normally use, if you use a decision tree. Decision tree is a highly expressive one. You know that, and any number of attributes can be able to represent without any break. Without any break, you can be able to represent that. So it is easy to interpret also, easy to understand also. And performance comparable to decision tree is much better and can handle redundant attributes also. This is some of an advantage of the rule-based classifier. And better suited for handling the imbalanced classes. Okay. And only thing, problem it arises here, harder to handle missing values in the test set. In the test set, there may be a chances of some missing values, right? Those missing values, harder to find out those missing values. This is one of the problem with the rule-based classifier. But other things are, performance-wise and expressive-wise, and since if you use indirect method, then a decision tree can be used. That is more expressive way, right? We can understand quite easily. You can derive the rules, with the help of decision tree much better. Okay, it's more understandable. So these are some of the advantages of a rule-based classifier. Okay, so thank you very much for listening my lecture. So if you have any doubts or anything, please you can get back to me. Anytime. Thank you very much. Good day.